Welcome back to the Cosmic Classroom. So this week I heard a lot of questions about Kepler's laws. Mostly, many of you had questions about the understanding of what Kepler's law means, and also how can you memorize the different laws. There are also some questions regarding Newton's version of Kepler's law, which we'll treat somewhere else. So let's review Kepler's laws. So there are three laws. And I think that much you probably remember. So there are three laws. The first law is the one that says that planets orbit in elliptical orbit around the sun, with the sun in one of the focus of the ellipse. So let me try to draw an ellipse here. There. Let's put the sun in one of the focus. And of course, I'm exaggerating the ellipse, right? The real, if you were to really draw this to scale, it would look like a circle, right? You wouldn't be able to see it, how elliptical it is. That's just to make a point here. So there's the sun, and there's a planet here, and the first law says that the planet orbits in this elliptical orbit. That's it. Now, the second law draws on it. The second law adds something else to it. So the second law, I'll use the same drawing here. What the second law says is that the time that it takes the planet to move from this position here, let's say it's here August 1st, and it takes 2 months to travel here, and it will be there in September 1st then, right? So it says that while traveling, the planet covers an area here. And that area is constant. So if it takes 2 months to go from here to here, there is another place in this orbit that it will also take 2 months to go to, from there to there. Because the area here is the same. So it says, third law says that planets sweep equal areas in equal amount of time in the orbit. Now, it's often not clear how is it possible that this area here is equal to this one. How do I know that? So of course, in this case, I'll just draw it approximately. But you could convince yourself that this is very similar by getting something for which you know the area and see how many you can fit in there. So for example, you get some pennies. See how many you can fit in there. And you'll see that you'll be able to fit about as many in this side. The penny is a little bit too big to demonstrate here. But that's the idea of area, right? So it's the same real state in both places. The same real state is covered, but the shape is different. Kepler's second law, all right? So second law builds on the third one. The third one gets more confusing. The third one is the one that adds another planet to it, okay? So the third law now deals with comparison between two planets orbiting the sun. The first and second law are talking about one planet. In the third law, let's add another planet here in another orbit, all right, around the sun. There. So the third law states that the period of the amount of time that it takes for a planet to go around the sun square is proportional to the average distance from the planet to the sun, cube. And this is an empirical relationship. And Kepler didn't know why it was that way. He just noticed that that was a relationship. Notice that it makes sense. If A increases, let's imagine that this is Earth at one astronomical unit. If you're now at two astronomical units, of course it's going to take longer to go around because the path is longer. But not only it takes longer because the path is longer, but actually the planets are moving slower. further from the sun. You can think about it like they are attracted less to the sun, so they are slowed down. So a planet, an outer planet here is moving at a certain velocity, while the inner planet is moving at a faster speed, a faster velocity. And this got really busy. But I hope you followed. Just to give you a little bit more on Kepler's third law, which is the more complicated one. It dares to have an equation in there, which you really don't like, I know. Kepler's third law. So I would like to give you one more specific example. So let's imagine, so we have the sun here, right there. And then there is the Earth going around the sun in something that should look more or less like a circle. You shouldn't be able to say that it's an ellipse. So here's the Earth. Here's the sun. And you know that the Earth is at a distance of one astronomical unit from the sun. That's the definition of an astronomical unit. And it takes 1 year for the sun to go around, for the Earth to go around the sun. 1 year. Now, at about 3 astronomical units from the sun, we have something called the asteroid belt. So I'm going to try to draw something that's 3 times further away, all right? Here. It's called the asteroid belt. It doesn't have any planets on it, but it has a lot of little rocks there. No planet was formed in there because Jupiter is nearby and keeps, you know, messing them up. But there are a bunch of, you know, little rocks in here. And those little rocks are also orbiting the sun. The rocks are at 3 times that distance, 3 astronomical units from the sun. So let's see how long it takes for the asteroids to complete one full orbit, right? According to Kepler's third law, we know the relationship between the period and the distance from the sun. We know that p squared equals a cubed. So if the distance is 3, so we have that p squared equals 3 cubed, meaning p squared equals about 27. And if you take the square root of this, p is square root of 27, p is approximately, this is the sign for approximately, 5 years. So it takes 5 years for the asteroids to complete one orbit. But notice that they are only traveling a distance that it's 3 times greater than Earth, right? The radius is 3 times, the distance is just 3 times greater. But it's taking 5 times as long to go around, which leads us back to the conclusion that the asteroids are traveling at a slower speed than Earth. And that's it for Kepler's Law. I hope it helped. See you next time.